Interracial Jawn with Drew and Leslie. Get the shit on. Interracial Jawn. Shut the fuck up and listen. Interracial Jawn. Interracial Jawn. Interracial shit motherfuckers. Shut up and listen. Drew and Leslie. Interracial Jawn.
Bell for that one.
Hey, welcome to the Interracial Jawn podcast. I'm your host, Leslie Mack, and I'm joined as always
by one very white guy.
And he is very white indeed. And we are back like a bad habit.
Yeah, you know, should we play what is a Jawn since it's been a while? Could you let people know what Jawn is?
We can play that in a little bit.
All right.
I wanted to just, say thank you to our listeners who probably were like, dang, I guess they're never coming back.
Hey, did you look how long has it been? It's got to be like a couple of years.
No, not that long. It's been, well, we put out a couple of episodes this fall. The last one we put out was literally called Back-ish, which I thought was pretty funny. And
we just did one?
We did two. But it's been a while, but we are back and I'm very excited about it. We have been talking about wanting to podcast again, but I don't know. I feel like it was like, I know there was just a bunch of stuff having to do with podcasting that we just didn't have bandwidth for right now, but we did want to come back and start podcasting again. And we were lucky enough to connect with our good friends, Clove and Shirley from the Chonilla podcast up in Canada. And they started very recently a network, a podcast network and content creator network. And so we were lucky enough. They said, yes, they would love to have us on their podcast network. And so we are officially now part of the Chonilla Network, which is an independent digital media company specializing in podcasts, video series, and live streams. It's a community of content creators that support each other in producing diverse, high quality content through funny, educational, and thought-provoking conversations. And so you can find all of our archived episodes on the Chonilla Network, and you can also find us on way more platforms than you could before. So we're like on Spotify and like iHeartRadio and all of these fancy places now.
I'm just gonna like geek out a little bit. Like Clove's like an audio, like he's got a MIDI board, like he does the things
he's
with the
very serious.
Like I'm super jealous of their setup. And on the other end, Shirley's like a podcast like wizard. She was saying things like
I was like, I don't know what the heck that means.
Yeah, I was like, there's even like our stuff. I was embarrassed, but like we had a WordPress website. We like managed ourselves and we just load files. But they like wrote to us like, oh, like what, you know, where do you host? I'm like, here. And like, well, can you get them? I'm like, I don't know what to do. Here's the login. And they did it all. Like they literally scraped everything down, uploaded it. Like they made it real. They're awesome. I'm impressed.
It's very impressive. So I'm really excited about that. And so you'll see probably some new like bumpers at the beginning and the end of the show you'll hear. And so they have a couple of other shows, including their show, the Chonilla podcast, which is really great and amazing. And my favorite segment on their show is Bible Studies 90210, where Clove actually basically goes through every book of the Bible, but talks about it as if it's a teen drama. And it's very entertaining and a great way to get a little, Bible study in.
Yeah.
And so they have new episodes that are back. So a couple of, well, I guess now we can talk about what a Jawn is if you want
to
play
that. I'm really thinking like this is a weird like deja full circle moment.
Okay.
Because we first started listening to Chonilla. We like listened to their podcast before we started podcasting.
True.
And then we did one podcast at our home and like in front of your Mac computer. And we're like, oh, as long as we enjoy this, we'll keep doing it.
Yep.
And like everything, we jumped right into it. And I don't know if you remember, we went to visit friends in Grand Rapids before we moved. And we went on their podcast as guests.
Yeah, we did. We were like guests.
The first
on
podcast we ever did was a guest on the Chonilla.
It's true. It is very full circle. And also they're really good friends of ours. So, it's like win-win-win because we get to work with them. So, so I'm really excited about that. But in case we have some new listeners, because we are on this new network
and
on all these new places where folks can listen to us, I guess. Yeah, so we started this podcast when we were living in Philadelphia, which is where we've lived the most time that we've been together, at least up till this point. And so we
Go Birds!
No.
No? No, if I guess what? All right.
No. we're not doing the NBA, the NFL anymore. All right,
scratch
so,
that.
No. yeah, F the NFL. Yeah, so we lived in Philadelphia, and so John is a Philly area word that is actually a noun, a person, place, or thing, and can be utilized in any number of ways. I think you have a little video to
this is Tessa Thompson, who was in the Rocky reboots, yes. The Creed movies.
They're not reboots, it's just Creed.
Creed, movies. I guess you're right. The extension of the Rocky brand,
yes.
The Creed movie, and it was her on a radio TV station explaining the word John.
There are Philly turns of phrases, like John is something that is said, it's a noun, it's a person, place, or thing. So this, for example, is a John. These papers are a John. This table is a John.
What do you
this
mean?
Place
what does that mean?
Is a John. I mean, it means anything. It's a noun. So literally everything is a John.
Wow. A John?
A John, yeah.
Spell it.
J-W-N, John.
Okay, John.
A John.
All right.
Yes.
Very good. We're learning lots of stuff. Yeah. So I would be able to say, that's a lovely John you're wearing.
You would.
Okay. Bam,
and you could also say of me, you could say, who's that John in the John?
And her accent on John is perfect.
It is very good. And I will say, people do in Philly, they'd be like, oh man, I gotta go get this John to the John. Like, that's a very common, like, you'll use John twice in a single sentence to mean two different things. But anyways, we are the Interracial John. And let's see, were there, I don't know, we'll do a little bit of catching up, but I also just wanted to mention that you should expect shorter episodes from us moving forward. They're not going to be quite as expansive. Part of that is just so that we can make sure that we actually do the podcast, and the other part is that podcasting has changed since we did our first 150 or so episodes.
Oh, we did?
And so we want to just cater to a new audience and make sure that we're getting good quality content, but you're not listening forever. So this should take you, you know, on your drive into work or something like that, not take you 2 hours to listen to. Okay, so what has been going on? I mean, so many things.
Yeah, look, the last we did pretty good up through like 2018, August 2018.
Yeah, yeah.
And then so it's been 18 months where you got 2 episodes.
Yeah.
But yeah, it looks like it might have been a couple of reviews since we left.
I don't know. We'll deal with that another day, not today, because we've got a lot of things.
keep it tight.
Yeah, we got to keep it tight. We're already probably over time as it is. So so I don't know if there's any like new stuff you want to tell the listeners about. I've been significantly involved in electoral politics for the last couple of months since this summer, really. And that's been an interesting endeavor. I've been to Iowa, South Carolina, Boston, supporting Elizabeth Warren, hashtag President Warren today. And it's been an interesting, you know, I stayed out of electoral politics for a really long time. And and so I just really was looking at myself kind of like, okay, 2016 was such a fucking nightmare. And what's going to be different this time around? And I was like, well, I can control myself, so I'm going to just do something different. And so that's what I've been doing. It's been an eye-opening experience. You were on the road with me last week, which was really fun as a surrogate for the senator in South Carolina. As we're hurtling towards South Carolina's primary in just a couple of weeks. And we also went to our local DNC district meeting this weekend, which was very interesting. I'd like to hear your thoughts about that, because I've never been, I've been a Democrat and like registered as a Democrat in multiple states, but I've never been involved in the actual like Democratic committee like structure. So I went because I actually want to be a delegate at the convention this year in Milwaukee. And you know, you don't have to go, but I think it's good to like show your face.
Sure.
I still want to get more information about it, and there's more stuff to do. So anyways, we both went to see and sat at our little table in our area. It was really eye-opening, both on the data side. I was really, you know, you move somewhere and you make a lot of assumptions about things. And I, you know, it was comforting to see just how blue our little piece of Charlotte is in particular. And that was really nice. It was also just kind of like the most hodgepodgiest of, like, it really was a sample section of the electorate in such a like direct way. I guess it's skewed probably a little older than maybe.
As a lot of the stuff does.
But I do think District 12 might skew older based on our neighbors anyways. I think it actually might not be that far off. I'd be interested to see what the other district meetings look like. But what were your thoughts around it?
I mean, to the age, we're 45 and 47 and about to be 45.
I'm not 45.
I'll give it 44, about to be 44. But we were the youngins in the room. We were the young folk compared to. But it was probably exactly what I expected in terms of like painful minutia that is interesting, probably, you know, to some but not everybody. And I'm very, like, I'm trying to get the word, not like the rules and stuff, like all the just very sort of ordered and regimented in some ways. But I thought it was fine. And it was, like you said, very interesting to see the demographic changes. And then demographically, our neighborhood specifically, like even the turnout was quite diverse and a good number of people for, I don't know, I don't think it's that big a district, but I was surprised. It was like, you know.
Yeah, it was 50, good.
60 people there?
Yeah, I mean, it was a good showing. I was, we had like 12 from our little precinct over here. So, yeah, that was good to see. It was just interesting to me. So, you know, whatever. And the person that I did talk to Dr. Amin yesterday, and it definitely was the person she had told me about.
I knew it could have been. Couldn't, it had to be.
She had already told me stories about this person and how she had showed up at like another event and had been given 2 minutes to speak and spoke for 17. And that it like cost the event planners like all this money because it ran that basically the entire program late. And anyways, I was not surprised. So that's why I was like, oh, I think I know her because I've heard about her before. I'm not going to say nobody's name, so I just need to keep it cute. But it was funny.
Yeah, the same individual, and we didn't even talk about this. They have a period of time where they're allowing Democrats in elected office to come up and talk and say, I'm a person, I'm running for this office.
I'm running for lieutenant governor, I'm running for judge, I'm running for whatever the hell.
One of them was a very pleasant woman, and I forget her name and forget the position, but her husband, wearing a shirt with her name emblazoned on it, is handing out flyers at all the tables, and she's like...
While she's talking, like, oh, she's talking, here's the material.
Yeah.
Being a good campaign husband.
So she stood up and asked him to stop.
Could you ask this person to stop? Because we can't see you while he's passing out these materials.
That lovely person is my husband.
That's my husband. Let's thank him very much. Thank him very much. You don't need to yell at him because he's grown. Anyways, yeah, that was really funny and interesting.
They had moon pies.
So you were excited about that.
I'm just saying, like, they had, like, cookies, moon pies.
Now that you know they have moon pie, that's, like, a reason to go back.
I don't know if that's a reason to go back, but there's, like, a lot of different things you could put on a snack, like, hodgepodge table.
Like, and moon pies are high on your
Yeah, we can keep them in the house on the reg.
True, true, true.
I was really excited. Put that right in my pocket. Moon pie for later. Cookie for now, moon pie for later.
So that was an interesting thing. So it's funny because the only other thing I wanted to mention about it was like Mike Bloomberg is literally using voter suppression tactics to steal this election, this primary, and it's really fucking disturbing to me.
That ad, I'm the first to bitch and moan about Bernie Bros, and I'll talk about them and I'll say this, that ad he put out was like
they put a response out. It's very funny. It's like all these sexual assault allegations against Bloomberg.
Yeah, so. It's just a really gross.
And they
ad.
Did it like they did it like exactly the same with the bells and everything. It's
bells.
Very funny.
It was I have a on the jingle palette. There's different like horns you can put on.
Yeah.
They call that the movie horn. Like, and he did that like 12 times in a 30-second spot with tweets and shit.
He's just terrible. I mean, the fact that he's bypassing the primary states, that's voter suppression.
Yeah.
You know, the way that he spent $200 million on ads so far in this race. That is nuts.
That's insane.
He doesn't. And look, let's be clear. Like, it's really, really awful. And I have some of his literature here, which I thought was really interesting because he says, as President Mike.
And
so the second thing that's on this list, I don't even need to read the first one because it's ridiculous. It says, get special interest influence out of politics. Mike never has and never will take a dime from them. Sir. You are the fucking special interest.
You are the interest.
You literally are the interest.
You're the individual
what
special
interest. What are you talking about right now? Like, how do you... Oh, my God. It's so gross. And he's just throwing money
you know
everywhere.
What, you know what I kind of feel like? There's what? These billionaires have seen what 45 has
sure.
done. And they're like, oh, fucking A. Like, I can just...
Absolutely.
I can... Even if not moving public funds to private hands, the number of times that he has tweeted or said something about China and trade and tariffs that have, like, made massive swings in markets. You fucking know he's shorting and making moves based on the shit he's going to tweet and say.
Absolutely. And Bloomberg would do that and then some.
He'd get bigger pockets. He's got bigger pockets.
Exactly.
He could do it on a larger scale.
Literally. Oh, we need a... You got your racist, sexist billionaire. We got our own racist, sexist billionaire. Awesome. Fuck that. Fuck Mike Bloomberg forever and a day. Fuck him for ruining New York City. Fuck him for stop and frisk. Fuck him for Kalief Browder. Fuck him for so many things. It's out of control. I actually have a PDF. Maybe I'll put it in the show notes of the shit that Mike Bloomberg, his entire, and I'm going to say this, this motherfucker served 3 terms because he changed the law while he was in office to serve a 3rd term. And then before he left, closed it so nobody else could do that after he left office. Okay, I just want to be clear. This is the type of individual that we're talking about. And, well, we have a segment, so let's play the intro.
Here we go. Let me segue.
Yeah, so, you know, of course, I mentioned stop and frisk, which was, you know, a horrible practice that is still going on around the country and in New York City. And Mike Bloomberg's, when he was leading as mayor in New York City, used this tactic to basically roust and assault specifically black and brown men in New York City because they did all the crime, according to him. And so, therefore...
And there's actual empirical data that shows,
and there has been empirical data for a very long time
before these policies,
before any of this shit happened, and everybody was saying this shit doesn't work.
And let's just be really clear, it's not just doesn't work. The empirical data is that black and white folks use drugs and do crime at exactly the same rate, so there's no reason to stop one versus the other. And actually stop and frisk has a higher success rate when they go after white people, because white people know that, like, you can just carry shit all the time and not get away with it, and black people know they get stopped and frisked all the time. So it's like, it's doubly stupid.
It also, like, actually incentivizes black and brown, especially men who get stopped and frisked, to commit crime. Because here's the thing, if you already are being treated like a criminal, why would you not just become one?
Mm.
It's like, it's the anti-deterrent. It's so terrible on so many levels. It's also like we have a generation of black and brown men who have PTSD. I talk to my nephews about this all the time, about how, like, there just became a point during Mike Bloomberg's presidency where, like, they just couldn't hang out in groups anymore.
Oh, yeah.
They just refused to do it because they knew it meant they were going to get stopped and frisked. And not that they were doing anything wrong, but it's trauma to be assaulted by police officers. They also continually sexually assaulted. This is what the NYPD would do. They would penetrate because they always included an underwear check in these stop and frisks. You know, this was an insidious policy that he fought tooth and nail. The federal government had to issue a decree to force this man to stop doing it. But Mike Bloomberg thought he could just apologize on Twitter. So let's
read the tweet first.
Let's get into that. I have apologized for taking too long to understand the impact of stop and frisk on black and Latino communities. I inherited stop and frisk. In an effort to stop gun violence, it was overused. I cut it back by 95%. I should have cut it back sooner. Bitch, if you don't get the entire fuck out of my face, you're a liar. You're a racist. You are literal capitalist scum. And this okey-doke that you're trying to pull, it's been so disturbing to watch prominent black people come out in support of this man because he's been funding their campaigns, their non-for-profits for the last couple of years. I mean, people that I literally had to actually say, like, I'm so disappointed in you. And the response is like, I understand. You understand? That's what you have to say. You understand?
Billions.
So I'm going to read that. So that was the tweet. Let's read this three paragraph actual apology, yeah, and then we can give it a grade. And just to remind people, we grade apologies quite often. We have a scale. The things that we expect to see in a 5-star. Actually, we do 1 to 10. So a 10 yeah, point apology or an expression of regret, an explanation of what went wrong, acknowledge responsibility, a declaration of repentance, like I will do better, an offer of repair. Is there something that they should be doing? A request of forgiveness without expectation, and timeliness, juxtaposition, and modality. Okay.
So you keep those in mind. And I'll read this paragraph.
That last thing I said, the timeliness, juxtaposition, yeah, modality is already like null and void. Because, nigga, you wouldn't have been saying shit about this except for the fact that you're running for president.
Yeah, and got called out about
it. You've never apologized prior to now, but okay. And let's get into this
statement. He apologized because people were rightfully so, using it as leverage against him, sure, you know, in a variety of ways.
As they should. And being like, black people, hello.
Yeah.
I know you may not have lived in New York City, but let me tell you what happened. Let me show you. Let me make you aware of what he did to people. Okay, yeah, here we go.
Let me read this paragraph because I want you to look at the A through G, the seven things.
Sure.
Because I don't think he hit any of them.
Probably none, yes.
Because he starts with President Trump, which is weird. President Trump's deleted tweet is the latest example of his endless efforts to divide Americans. I inherited the police practice of stop and frisk, and as part of our effort to stop gun violence, it was overused. By the time I left office, I cut it back by 95%.
Forced.
But I should have done it faster and sooner. I regret that and I have apologized, which is weird. Like, is that past tense? I have apologized. Mm. Anyway, I regret that and I have apologized. And I have taken responsibility for taking too long to understand the impact it had on black and Latino communities.
Where's their responsibility? Keep going.
But this issue and my comments about it do not reflect my commitment to criminal justice reform and
racial
equity. So
your comments about it don't reflect your... Okay, keep going.
I love it when people say the words that are taken out of
the
context.
The words that came out of my mouth? I didn't really mean that, though. Sir.
I believe we need to end mass incarceration. And during my tenure, we reduced incarceration by 40% and juvenile confinement by more than 60%. I'd like to know the actual data because I'm betting that reduction was prisons moving into like...
Absolutely.
Out of
New York City, yeah, and also transitioning from
state to federal.
No, not state to federal. From to detention centers, so like ICE detention centers.
Got it.
So that's another thing that happens. It's like they take you off. Like, oh, we decreased. Like, you just moved immigrants to detention centers, and now you get to say they're not in jail anymore, even though they are in jail. But go ahead.
I'm trying not to say this without laughing too hard. Actually, Bloomberg really got a benefit because Sean King shut down Rikers. You know.
Oh, that's right. So even though Rikers still is open, but keep going.
Anyway, we created the Young Man's Initiative to help young men of color stay on track for success, which President Obama built on to create My Brother's Keeper. And we overhauled a school system that had been neglecting and underfunding schools in black and Latino communities for too long.
The overhaul included all these charter schools that have been doing horrible with black and brown communities. But go on.
And again, why this is the end there in part of your apology, I don't get it. In contrast, President Trump inherited a country marching towards greater equality and divided us with racist appeals and hateful rhetoric.
That's interesting because when Trump won, you said that it was President Obama's fault that the nation was so divided. Okay, keep going.
I forgot about that.
I just want to be clear on what is happening.
That's a tick, Bloomberg. The challenge of the moment is
clear. He's a fucking liar. This whole thing is a lie.
Yes, it's nuts. The challenge of the moment is clear. We must confront this president and do everything we can to defeat him. The president's attack on me clearly reflects his fear over the growing strength of my campaign. Make no mistake, Mr. President, I'm not afraid of you, and I will not let you bully me or anyone else in America. Between now and November, I will do everything I can to defeat you, whether I am on the ballot or not.
Yeah, right. Anyways, first of all, he's running regardless of what happens. It's clear he doesn't give a shit about this primary.
He's going to be an independent,
and
period.
He'll just run and fuck up and Trump will be elected again. Please, everybody listening that's in America, I just beg of you, just Google Mike Bloomberg, black people, and that's it. Just do that. You'll have a ton of things that will come up that will show you. I mean, this is a man who literally anything that was a positive for marginalized communities, he fought tooth and nail, made people go to court, federal court, to make him do things like ensure that all New York City taxi cabs were ADA compliant. He fought that. This is the type of individual, because it didn't make good sense. There's this clip of him going around right now. He's having a conversation, I think in Hasidic community, talking about the expense of healthcare and how it's getting so expensive. He's like, you know, we need to get to the point. Like, if you're 95 and you come in and you say you have cancer, it's like, well, you lived a good life. It's time to make you comfortable. And we need to get prepared to do that. End quote.
Isn't that the death panels that they all were like really afraid that was actually going to happen with the Affordable Care Act?
I just don't understand. Like, the whole thing about it is like, you're supporting this dude because he's been throwing his money around and because he put some money into, like, I don't know, gun violence. He probably makes money off of guns. I don't even know if that's true, but I'm just saying it because I can.
Well, let's do the.
Let's go through the list and see where Mike has come up. So expression of regret. No.
Well, the word "I regret that." And I have apologized.
I think the "and I have apologized" cancels out the regret part.
It certainly isn't a very
explanation.
The veracity.
Explanation of what went wrong. Nope.
He made an excuse after the fact. I inherited it.
Yeah, that's not an explanation. Acknowledge responsibility. He literally shirked responsibility throughout the quote unquote apology. Declaration of repentance. I will do better. Nope. He claims he's already done better. So that didn't happen.
And not only did he not say he didn't do a declaration, but he said that weird thing you said, like, I didn't. These statements and words don't reflect my real thoughts.
Yeah. But I just said them, but they don't mean
And whenever
anything.
People say
this.
This
is what I'm saying now is what I
really struggle with that, because it's like, all we really have is your actions. We can only go on your actual behavior.
Yeah, your behavior sucks.
What you say doesn't really matter. So now you're telling us to,
freaking sucks.
Like, don't believe what I do. Believe what I say.
Yeah, it's terrible. Okay, let's see. Offer of repair.
Nah.
So this is interesting because Sam Sway today posted that Mike Bloomberg has enough money to give every black male that was stop and frisk during his tenure $90,000 today.
Every single one.
Yes. He did the math because that's what Sam does. Shout out to you, Sam. He couldn't even offer that. He couldn't even offer $9 to these people. So, okay, keep going.
I don't know if I want to talk about it, but like, I feel like I heard you talking about volunteers that sign up to work for him get like phones and iPads and shit.
Oh yeah, look, but we don't want to talk about that on air because like it might make people go do it. So, like, literally, that's what he's doing. He's literally just buying people, paying obscene amounts of money to organizers and people that doesn't even matter what your experience is. He just wants to have you on the payroll so that you won't be on somebody else's and you won't be working for somebody else's candidate. And it's really gross and disgusting to see. As I've been working on a campaign that's not even taking non-private funds, like Senator Warren's campaign is completely individual donor fundraising. Like, that's it. There's no PACs. There's no super PACs. There's no nothing. And it's been a hallmark of the campaign. And to see at the start of Elizabeth's campaign that be such a positive thing, and now to watch this man come in with all of his money and just throw it all around, just literally just throw it in the air, throw it away. It doesn't even matter what he's doing with it. It's irrelevant because his capital is so great that wherever he spends it, it will benefit him. And it's just obvious to me, he just doesn't want to pay the wealth tax that Elizabeth would make him pay. And he's willing to spend a whole lot of fucking money, including $200 million.
I mean, he's done the math, what he would pay his two cent wealth tax.
Well, I think beyond that, it's like, I think I saw a thing that said that if he's worth like whatever 200 and whatever billion, if he had been paying taxes at the rate that people are talking about now in this cycle, the progressive candidates anyways, his fortune today would only be 41 billion. So you can see directly that this is going to affect him in a way that, even though $41 billion, like, literally nobody that is ever in your line would ever have to work again anyhow, but whatever. Sure. You need more, apparently. And then request of forgiveness without expectation. He actually expects you to vote for him. So I would say that disqualifies him from that one. And then I already talked about the timeliness, juxtaposition, and modality. So he gets a big fat fucking zero.
Yeah, it's not. If there was even like maybe like a half of whatever, the timeliness, juxtaposition, modality, like you said, it wipes it all out.
Yeah, absolutely.
No, it's a non-starter.
Absolutely.
White people, I get bullied in school. I can't wait till I'm a cop so I can bully you. White people.
Hey,
hey, hey, hey.
White people.
Fucking white people. All right.
White people.
I actually hadn't seen that one.
Oh, no, Zoe.
White people.
white people.
She's so serious about it. Like, she understood, like,
white people. Okay.
I actually read this when it came out like 2 weeks ago, and you and I never talked about it. I just literally, it was one of those ones that, like, I won't call it clickbait, but like you saw the headline, I was like, Jesus, I got to read this. Yeah. And I read it, I was like, you got to be fucking kidding me.
Yeah. So you want to read it? You want me to read it?
I'll read it.
Okay, go ahead.
So a university professor, let's get the actual article. A University of Oklahoma professor has apologized after saying, okay, boomer is the same as saying that epithet that we shan't say.
Yes.
The university student newspaper reported, and when a student made the comment Tuesday, the journalist must keep up with our younger generations, the professor said that was the equivalent of saying okay, boomer to him. The OU Daily reported, calling someone a boomer is like calling someone the N-word, the professor then said.
Said the N-word.
Yeah, he with a hard R.
He didn't say the N-word, like the phrase. He said the actual N-word.
He said the word. Okay. He did. And according to the paper, which said some of the staff were in the class and witnessed the exchange. So this is like firsthand daily OU staff.
Yes, they were in the room.
And so we could almost go and do another apology for him. But the professor says, I realize the word was hurtful and infuses the racial divisions of our country, past and present, the professor wrote according to the paper. Use of the word is inappropriate in any, especially educational settings. CNN has reached out to the professor for comment, but has not heard back. University's interprofessor Joseph Harris condemned the comparison earlier in the day, saying while the professor's comments are protected by the First Amendment and academic freedom, his comment
that's
and
how
word
you know
choice
he's right. He's
are
white.
Fundamentally offensive and wrong. Oh, he's got tenure too. The use of the most offensive word by a person in a position of authority hurt and minimized those in the classroom and beyond. The term okay boomer, a viral meme among millennials and Generation Z, exploded last year on the TikTok social media app, where countless mocking videos are calling out what young people perceive as out of touch baby boomers and their patronizing opinions.
Okay, boomer.
Okay,
anyways,
boomer.
So the thing I thought was really funny about this was not funny, but interesting to me is like that I've seen so many like progressive left socialists, professors get fired for writing their thoughts, whatever.
Sure.
And it's so interesting that this university president came and was like, oh, well, he's protected First Amendment because white people, First Amendment.
Yeah. What was the other thing? Academic freedom. Uh-huh. Sure.
Okay, here.
And they just, okay, boomer, like really, like show me where the meme hurt you, sir. Like touch
Please,
me. Point me on your body where the meme, you know, did you wrong, because good Lord, like you're that hurt. And I always think this, and I honestly, it bothers me because I know that white people view that epithet as some sort of like, you know, exciting third rail that you touch for, you know what I mean? Like, oh, I want to say it. They could say it, so can you. But literally the history of that word, if most white people knew just a fraction of the torment, the death, the terror that have been inflicted with that word, you would never deign to want to say it, much less that it's the equivalent of okay fucking boomer, you know?
Yeah, it's definitely not. Also, okay boomer, like these boomers are so in their feelings about being old. I'm so fucking sick of them. Like they have given up no power anywhere in industry and education and governmental structures. Like literally, they've had a fucking chokehold on everything in this country for decades and decades, my entire lifetime, and now they're mad that their people are like, you're fucking out of touch. What the fuck
and
is wrong with them?
Okay, boomer. Like, it's even like if you were gonna have a like Gen Z millennial, like it's like the
it's
mildest.
So
of,
mild.
It's so
it's
mild.
So okay is
okay,
in it.
Okay,
I can't stand
and like
that.
Their generation are called baby boomers.
Literally.
They refer to themselves as the greatest generation. Like
no. The greatest generation is a different generation.
Oh, right. But anyway, they're the actual baby boomers. Like it's in their generational name. Like you're mad at somebody saying okay, and then like
I can't.
It actually smacks so much of white people being mad at being called white.
Absolutely. This is definitely that thing of them being like, how dare you call me anything at all, even though if I am that thing. Don't do it.
Okay, boomer.
Okay, boomer. So we have a new segment. Ooh. We're gonna close out the show with.
Who said that? Who said that? Who said that?
Who said that?
Who said that?
Who said that?
Who
said that?
Who said that?
It's on a loop, so it'll keep playing. Okay, so this is a new segment called, you guessed it, Who Said That? I'm
okay.
Going to pull a quote out, and it will certainly be something that from somebody who's currently in the news,
okay,
or, you know, being spoken about. I will give you a hint this week that it does have to do with politics. Okay, so here's the quote.
Okay.
For me, One of my earliest memories of politics, where I thought I could do anything, was when Walter Mondale of Minnesota picked Geraldine Ferraro as his running mate. I literally remember what she wore, the red dress, the white pearls, and I saw that and I thought, anything is possible.
It's the 45's daughter that's all over the place.
Nope.
His wife?
No.
Who said it?
One Senator Amy Klobuchar. Because she's from Minnesota, as is Mondale.
Minnesota. Yeah. I guess I was too old. Mondale was 80-something.
Yes, the, you were going
45 was too young.
Ivanka certainly was too young. Yeah. But yeah, so that's from Senator Amy Klobuchar. People seem to think is somehow relevant in this race, even though she's completely ridiculous. She's also a whole cop, so I'll mention that as well. I got to hear her speak, and the end of her speech was like, and I'm probably not going to win, so vote Democrat. And I laughed, and it was really funny. And then I got to actually meet her in Iowa, because Iowa is very weird during the primaries, and you literally would just run into Amy Klobuchar without a bra getting drunk with John Delaney in a hotel lobby, and because that's a real thing that happened. And so I got to talk with her, and she had actually some interesting things to say about what she feels is like, how sexism plays out on the campaign trail, and the ceiling that she has experienced, or she thinks it, you know, just exists for black, not black women, but for women generally to run. I think for black women, it's even less. Mm. Anyways, so that's a new segment.
Who said that?
So Amy Klobuchar said that.
Amy Klobuchar. Okay.
Yes, a red dress and white pearls really is what set
her her political journey
to try and run for office. So that take that for what it's worth, folks, and definitely don't vote for Amy Klobuchar in the primary.
I remember when I think it was in like the sixth grade, and they did like the sixth grade votes. And people just did what their parents were doing. And I was like one of the very few people on the Mondale Ferraro side. And the actual election, they got clobbered. Mm. And I remember it being very misogynistic and sexist driven and stuff against, obviously. But I'm glad I spoke to Amy Klobuchar, you know? Mm-hmm. And her constituents, I hope, I guess. I don't know. I'm not in Minnesota. I don't know how she does.
She does terrible with black people. Okay. Every black Minnesota, I was like, Amy Klobuchar, are you fucking kidding me? She's a nightmare. Literally, her record as a prosecutor there is atrocious, and literally where she would like ignore if it was a black defendant, and she would ignore exonerating evidence, like wouldn't let people while they were on trial go to their mom's funerals. Shit like heinous shit. She's terrible. Yeah. And her bangs are horrible also. So that's even worse. It's like double bad. I think that's it. That's the show.
I think we're under 45, but tight 35, 40 minutes.
Huzzah. We did it. So, you can find us anywhere that you can find podcasts. Just search Interracial Jawn. That's JAWN. And check out the other podcasts on the Chonilla Network.
Please.
Which is the Chonilla podcast, as well as the Black Canadian Content Creators Network. So check out all of those. And you can go to chonillanetwork.com to see the rest of our brother and sister shows out there. And yeah, we'll be back very soon.
We're in the pipe. Bye. Bye.
Yeah,
bye.
Baby.
Good night, everybody.
High five.
High five.